So yeah, maybe a little nervous, but nothing too crazy. So today we're gonna read the triumphant entry. The last time that Jesus walked into Jerusalem before he was crucified. It is Mark 11, 1 through 19. You guys want to find that? Say amen if you got it. You got it if you need it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen, Jason. Pastor Jason. All right, if I can get you guys to stand, we'll read out the Bible. All right, Mark 11, 1 through 19. When they approached Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and told them, "Go into the village ahead of you. As soon as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here right away.' So they went and found a colt outside in the street, tied by a door, and they untied it. Some of those standing there said to them, What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them, 'Just as Jesus had said,' so they let them go. They brought the colt to Jesus and threw their clothes on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their clothes on the road, and others spread leafy branches cut from the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' He went into Jerusalem and into the temple. After looking around at everything, since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The next day, they went out from Bethany. He was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree with leaves, he went out to find out if there was anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, 'May no one ever eat fruit from you again.' And his disciples heard it. They came to Jerusalem, and he went into the temple and began to throw out those buying and selling. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves. He would not permit anyone to carry goods through the temple. He was teaching. 'Is it not written, My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations? But you have made it a den of thieves.' The chief priests and the scribes heard it and started looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was astonished by his teaching. Whenever evening came, they would go out of the city." Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for giving us these lessons. Thank you for walking into this city, even though you knew what that meant for you. Thank you for loving us enough to walk into that city and to walk through this next week, which is, it's horrific, the stuff that you had to deal with and you had to go through. Because you love us, because you want to build a relationship with us. Just so grateful to you, Lord. Just so grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So this was an amazing time. People were gathered together. They were following Jesus. They had seen many miracles, and I can only imagine what they were thinking. I believe that a lot of these folks were thinking that Jesus was going to end the occupation and send the Romans back to Rome. I believe that there were a bunch of folks in the crowd that were healed by Jesus and were filled with gratitude. And they probably wanted to see him, to touch him again, just wanting to express their love. I bet there were folks that had just lost a loved one or were sick themselves and needed to be healed. We know that there were priests and Pharisees and Sadducees, and they wanted Jesus dead. So there was gratitude, love, depression, anger, and grief. But I wonder where Jesus' mind was. I wonder what he was feeling. We know that he was working through the process of fulfilling the covenant. And So I believe that his mind was there. But I wonder if he was thinking about this upcoming week. I wonder if he was thinking about the torment that he was going to have to suffer through. We always hear that Jesus died for our sins, right? Every year we hear that. Anytime you have anybody discipling to you, they're telling you that. We wear a cool little cross, some of us wear a cool little cross around our neck with a little Jesus on it. And he looks so serene and peaceful on that cross. But was it just like a nice peaceful thing? I don't think so. He was spit on and punched. He was whipped with a scourge. And you know what a scourge is, right? It's not just a whip. You know, we hear that he was whipped. And he was whipped. But the tool that they used had a handle and then a bunch of different whips on it. And on these strands of leather, they would tie pottery and rocks and glass so that when they whipped him, it would rip through his flesh and pull stuff off him. They say he wasn't even recognizable, but he knew exactly what was going to happen. Remember, he's God. So he knew the exact things that would happen. He knew the saliva drying on his face as they spit on him. He could probably feel the bones crunching underneath their knuckles as they punched him in his face. As they yelled and humiliated him, or tried to humiliate him. I don't think they could humiliate Jesus, but he knew the pain of the thorns as they pushed the crown down on his head, and those thorns ripped into his flesh and the blood flowed down his face and his neck and his back. The scourge, he knew the pain of feeling those little things ripping through his flesh. He knew the feelings of being betrayed by Judas and by Peter. He knew that stuff prior to. And he knew the feeling of the spikes. They weren't nails. They weren't like these like really cool finished nails that we're using nowadays. These were spikes, and they were pounding him. They were staking him to the cross. He knew that pain. He knew that pain, but yet he still walked into Jerusalem. It's horrifying. And I think it's a good thing to hear this, right? I think it's a good thing to know that what I just said, what I just talked about, was nothing. It was nothing compared to the torment and the torture that Jesus walked through. But he did that. He endured that torment and that torture. He endured them trying to humiliate him and spit on him and punch him and all of this stuff. He endured that because he loves us, because he wants to build a relationship with us. Mark 11, 1 through 7 says, when they approached Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and told them, go into the village ahead of you. As soon as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it and we'll send it back here right away. So they went and found the colt outside in the street, tied by a door. They untied it, and some of those standing there said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? They answered them just as Jesus had said, so they let them go. They brought the colt to Jesus and threw their clothes on it, and he sat on it. Jesus, with no military, no guard protecting him, on the back of the donkey, makes me think of humility. In the Old Testament, riding donkeys is what kings did. I used to think that the donkey was the humility piece, but I think that the humility piece was not having a guard there, not having helicopters and tanks and Secret Service all around and protecting them. Absalom, when he usurped King David, after he did, he rode a donkey. So the image of the donkey, I believe, is where Jesus is showing us that he's the king. Here's God, who could have had the finest the chariot, finest chariots, 100% divine, right? He was 100% human too, but he was 100% divine. So he could have came in riding angels, and he did. He rode the donkey. He deserved the best. He had brought people back to life and healed people. He had cast out demons and Satan himself. But he was going to ride a donkey with no guard, knowing that there were people that were in that crowd in Jerusalem that wanted to kill him. That donkey didn't have any training. He was just hanging out. But it was prophecy. And when Jesus needed him for his plan, that donkey was ready. It didn't matter what season it was. It didn't matter that he had no training. The donkey was ready to serve in God's plan. 500 years before this donkey was born, Zechariah spoke about this very moment. Zechariah 9:9 says, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout in triumph, daughter Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, humble, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So 500 years before Jesus, there was this man who had prophesied a righteous, victorious, humble king coming to us riding a donkey. So at that time, the Jewish folks were probably really looking into prophecy about the Messiah, because Jesus had already fulfilled some prophecy at this point. So probably like today, some of us are looking at end times prophecy and digging into that to see what it was. So I believe that that crowd, the people in that crowd, knew what was happening. I believe that they knew that this was prophecy. I keep thinking of that donkey, though, right? And how God used him to fulfill covenant. And I keep thinking about how that donkey was ready. Say, be the donkey. Come on, say, be the donkey. There we go. I know that's kind of silly. We're going to read Mark 11:8-11. "Many people spread their clothes on the road, and others spread leafy branches cut from the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' He went into Jerusalem and into the temple. After looking around at everything, since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. I wonder who exactly was in the crowd, right? In that crowd of people that were yelling, celebrating. I wonder if the man from the pool of Bethesda was there walking around. How about the daughter of Jairus and her family? How about the woman with the blood issues and the woman at the well? How about the prostitute? I wonder if the ex-possessed man from the tombs was there, so grateful, walking around in a suit and tie, trying to sell stuff. Because you remember, he went from absolutely crazy to Jesus cast out the demons and healed them. I wonder how their lives had changed. I wonder how happy they were. I wonder how happy they were to see Jesus. I think about them sometimes and think that after they were saved or healed, what new set of struggles and challenges awaited their new lives? I wonder if they're ready to be called into whatever God's plan was. Remember the guy from the pool at Bethesda? He had nobody to carry him down to the pool. So I wonder if he had family, right? I wonder if once he was healed, what he did. Did he go off and do some kind of internship at 10 acres or something like that? And who knows, right? But I wonder if they were ready to be called in like that donkey, if they were ready to be called into something. I'm going to read Mark 11:12-14. "The next day, they went out from Bethany. He was hungry. Seeing the distance, in the distance," I'm sorry, this kind of cracks me up a little bit because I didn't get this for so long. He was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree with leaves, he went to find out if there was anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples heard it. Why would Jesus curse a fig tree? Especially when it wasn't even in season. So this really confused me. No matter how I thought of it, I couldn't make sense of it. Last year when I was doing, when I was preparing for the Palm Sunday thing, I even sat with Jason and asked him, and he explained it to me, and I'm like, oh, I get it. Then I started thinking about that donkey again, right? There's this donkey who hadn't been ridden. He wasn't expecting that this day he'd be pulled into God's time. But when called, he answered the call. Now, I know that we'll never know what was in that donkey's head. And he was probably just being a good donkey, doing what good donkeys do. But he walked into that place. But what about us? What about you and me? Are we prepared to answer God's call? When God tells us to do something or sets us on a new path, are we ready to switch gears and lean in? And if we are ready, at a moment's notice, what's our heart posture? Right? Are we stomping around, throwing up our arms, all angry because I was going to watch a game and I was going to go out and get something to eat. Instead, God wants me to do this. Thanks, God. Are we showing the fruit of the Spirit? Just a quick reminder from a couple weeks ago, Jason did a series on this. Galatians 5:22-23 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things." But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things. I'm going to read that one more time. One more time. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things. When we describe, or when I describe, Jesus, when I'm discipling to folks in our treatment centers or our mental health places or wherever I'm at, those are the words that I use to describe Jesus, right? Yeah. So is Jesus asking him to reflect him? I believe he is. I believe as Christian men and women, we are supposed to reflect Christ in our daily walks. Yes, sir. But when he calls us into stuff, do we get angry, stomping and moping? Do we just refuse to change or move like the fig tree did? I think that the fig tree, right? The fig tree, everything is connected to God. And the fig tree knew that God was coming, right? God was coming down here and God was going to be hungry. And the fig tree's like, meh, not today. And so Jesus handled that business for sure. Unlike the fig tree, we should be prepared to change course when Jesus needs us to change course. Even when it's not our season. When God calls us into something, when Jesus calls us into something, it doesn't matter where we are, right? It doesn't matter what we know. It doesn't matter any of that stuff. None of that stuff matters because we will be equipped to do what we need to do. Sorry. I just think of all the stuff, right? All the things that Jesus has done for me, all the things that God has done for me. I have this amazing family doing this really cool job. I have this I have a group of friends that if I need something, I know that they'll lean in. Have a wonderful wife that I never ever argue with. Always, my heart posture is always the fruit of the Spirit with her, right? Yeah, probably not. She's back there laughing. I have all this stuff that Jesus has given me, right? And it all pales in comparison to salvation, right? It all pales, man. This cool little motorcycle that I ride around, it's cool, but it's nothing compared to salvation. I have all of these amazing things, right? And amazing people in my life that God has put there. God has put all these amazing people in my life. And I have that because I follow Jesus. Because when he says, hey man, I want you to get up and do Palm Sunday, I'm like, yeah, I'm on it. Even though I'm scared, even though I'm terrified inside, I get up and do it. When he says, I need you to stand up and do communion, or I need you to go into a place downtown where you know you're not going to be welcome and just talk about Jesus, I do it because I know that God is calling me to do stuff, and I need to walk into that. And I need to walk into that with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I need to do that. I don't. It's not a want anymore. I need to do that. Right? Okay. If God calls me, you know, we're not saved through works. Not at all. But if God calls me to work, man, I'm strapping my boots on, throwing a uniform on, and clocking in every single time. I say every single time. I try to do it every single time, because sometimes I'm a man, sometimes I don't do what I should do. Paul talks about that a little bit. I don't lean in like I should lean in. Or if I am leaning in, I'm like, yeah, let's get this over with. Let's get it done so I can just go about my day. Say, be the donkey. There we go. That's good, guys. Mark 11, 15 through 19 says, they came to Jerusalem, and he went into the temple and began to throw out those buying and selling. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves. He would not permit anyone to carry goods through the temple. He was teaching them, is it not written, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations? But you have made it a den of thieves. The chief priests and the scribes heard it and started looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him because the whole crowd was astonished by his teaching. Whenever evening came, they would go out of the city. I believe that there have been times in my life where Jesus has came in and flipped tables. I believe that there's been times in my life where I've been doing something that was not his plan, and he came in and flipped tables and chased me around with a whip, telling me I need to get on it. I remember the week I was saved, and a lot of you guys know this story, but I won't tell it anyway. My dad died when I was 3 years old, and I started using drugs when I was 5. When I was about 31, 32, I decided that I wanted to get clean and sober, right? So all this time, from 5 to 35, I was not a good dude. And I went through 4 treatment centers, and none of them worked for me. They were like non-spiritual treatment centers. They would tell you to... if you couldn't figure out a higher power in the 12-step process, they would tell you to pick a rock or a doorknob or something like that. And I always gave it 100%. Man, I would pray to that rock or that doorknob for serenity and all kinds of stuff. And within 12 hours of getting out of treatment, I was always high or drunk or doing something stupid. And then I went to the 5th treatment center. And the 5th treatment center I went to is a faith-based treatment center. And so that's what we do, right? We try to get you hooked up. We try to pair you up and talk to you and answer questions that you have so you can get it. But I was mad at God. I didn't want nothing to do with God. I hated God. If God hadn't taken my dad when I was 3 years old, none of that craziness would have happened. And I would have been a doctor or a lawyer or something like that. Probably not. But that's what was in my head, right? And I was angry, man. I would have people at the treatment center. And this is the faith-based treatment center, right? I'd have them come up and talk to me. And I'd tell them, stop telling me fairy tales. Stop telling me these stories. They're all fake. It's all wrong. Blah, 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 blah. Well, there was a guy there. His name was Mike Cooper. And he was real wise. Just a smart dude that just loved everybody, right? And I didn't understand that. I do now. But at that time, I was like, man, this guy's weird. But we'd have these really cool conversations. And then he'd steer it to God. He'd try to start discipling to me. And I'd be like, man, not going to listen to your fairy tales and walk off. Well, one night, I was talking to my son. He was 16 at the time. He's 32. But I was talking to him, and he was like, lose my number. You're not my dad. Don't ever call me again. I mean, all of this stuff, right? And I had it coming. I deserved that. But at the time, my ego said I didn't. So it tore me up really, really bad. And I went to talk to Coop. And this time, Coop turned that story or started talking about Jesus right away. And I grabbed him and I slammed him up against the wall. And I told him, if you ever tell me about God again, I'm going to beat you up. I didn't use those words. I wasn't saved yet, right? But, and I threw him on the floor and I went up to pack my stuff because I just assaulted this guy. And I knew that the cops were going to come. He was going to call the police. I was going to get arrested, go to prison again, sit there again, being an angry little dude. About a half hour went by. No cops had showed up. All my stuff was packed neatly, so if anybody needed to come pick it up, they could just take it with them. And I started feeling bad because, like I told you, man, I like Coop. Coop was a good dude. So I went down and I'm like, look, man, I'm so sorry for that. He's like, oh, no, it's okay. Are you going to go to church with me this Sunday? So he had a hook. Yeah, right? And I'm thinking, church, prison, church, prison. I guess I'll go to church. I just won't listen to anything. So I went to church, right? And I don't remember anything. I remember I was sitting in the front row and close enough to really hear Pastor Scott, and I don't remember anything he said. I was in the front row, so I could hear the worship team, right? And it was an amazing worship team. But I don't remember any of their songs. I just remember sitting there feeling this this amazing, overwhelming, scary, terrifying feeling. And I cried the whole time. Like, not like tears, little tears. I'm talking snot and ugly crying. And after Pastor Scott was done, he came down and sat next to me and put his arm around me, introduced himself, and just sat there with me for about 15 minutes. I knew something had changed inside of me. I was still mad at God. I still didn't want anything to do with God, but something had changed, right? And I knew I needed to start looking into it because that was supernatural. That was something I'd never dealt with. I'd never felt that. I never responded that way to anything. And so the next week I went back to church and I was saved. That was, I think, beginning of December 2008. So I've been clean and sober ever since.
Amen.
Right? But more important than that, we're walking with Christ ever since, right?
Yeah,
just a little update. About 6 years ago, I think it was 6 years ago, I was my son's best man at his wedding. So God restored that relationship 100%. But it sure felt like Jesus was flipping some tables and chasing me around with a whip. Maybe something even worse than that. But that's how it felt in my life, right? Jesus telling me, get ready, I've got work for you. Get ready, stand up, lean in, I've got work for you. And I never saw that, right? I never saw that. I never, my whole life, man, was filled with people in my life that was trying to get me high. People that wanted to use me. People, my whole life, man, was filled with that craziness. But Jesus was telling me, it's done. It's over with. I need you to lean in. And I haven't always been the dude that's standing up here, even after I was saved. I remember I moved into a house, and this house was horrible. It was horrible. I mean, there was, and I'm not exaggerating, there was 2.5, 3 feet of stuff on the ground. It was like, the garbage was like used syringes and dirty diapers and beer bottles and stuff like that. The first time we cleaned it out, we did it with snow shovels. It was rough, but it was $200 a month for a 3-bedroom house, so that's what I needed after treatment, especially in Sheridan, Wyoming. So we lived in that house 3 or 4 years and started working it. But anyways, before Amanda moved in, we were dating at the time. The bathroom, the glass on the bathroom, see, she's laughing back there. The glass sliding door on the tub had shattered, and there was glass everywhere, and we couldn't use it. And so Amanda, being a nice lady, and this is after I was saved, right? Amanda, being a nice lady like she is, she bought me a shower curtain. And I told my wife, who wasn't my wife at that time, if you think this means you're moving in with me, you're out of your mind. Yeah, and now she lives with me. No, seriously, and that's how it is. When you first start walking with Christ, man, everything doesn't change like that, right? You're not all of a sudden, I mean, you are a brand new person, right? You are a new person in Christ. But you still have to work out all those habits, all those things, those hang-ups that we walk around with. And it doesn't matter. I'm not even talking about addicts and alcoholics here, right? I'm talking about just new people in Christ who do stuff, man, that's not Christ-like, right? I talked earlier about reflecting Christ in our daily walk. And that sometimes starts out pretty slow. And it builds and builds and builds. Oh, sorry, I'll get back to it now. I kind of got out of it. So I think we need to be the donkey. I think we need to be prepared. I think we need to be ready for when God tells us to take a step. We need to be ready when God leans in and tells us we need to be ready. Don't be like the fig tree, because you don't want to be cursed. Produce no fruit. Be like the donkey who said, yep, whatever it is, I'm going to do it. Right? And walk into that with those fruits of the Spirit. Walk into that with all of that stuff, because that's where it's at, man. That's how we can reach the most people.